This is an outline of the SIS safety lifecycle from IEC 61511. It's effectively a flowchart of the stages of different activities needed to develop a safety instrumented system, SIS, and then operate it until it's decommissioned. Following slides will break down the typical activities in each stage. A central element of the SIS safety lifecycle is functional safety management, or FSM. A good FSM system will ensure that personnel are competent in the part of the lifecycle they are responsible for. It will provide effective policies, planning, and procedures to control lifecycle activities. Owners of major accident hazard sites need to identify hazards and make some grading of risk. There are several different ways of approaching hazard analysis, but many companies use a combination of study methods, often involving HAZOP. The systematic procedure ensures that hazards are captured and operability issues are also taken care of. If approached carefully, the process hazard analysis should provide good information on possible protection layers that can be considered in further studies like LOPA. After hazards and safeguards have been identified, there needs to be some further analysis of risk reduction measures. An effective technique for this is LOPA, Layer of Protection Analysis. This can allocate risk reduction to different layers, considering active and passive measures, and can eventually result in selecting SIL for functions within the SIS. Requirements are the blueprint for the SIS design. Functional requirements include what each safety function should do in terms of what hazard is to be detected and the action to be taken to reach a safe state. Integrity requirements set the standard for the design in terms of safety integrity and system availability. When the requirements are sufficiently complete and stable, appropriate SIS equipment can be selected. Standards require this equipment to be specially assessed. Usually, this will involve ensuring only SIL-capable devices are used from reputable suppliers. Each safety instrumented function will also need to meet some special criteria for fault tolerance of hardware and have a calculation for probability of dangerous failure. This is something not required for a non-SIS control system. Logic solver application programs will also be developed in this stage. Verification by review and testing will be required to meet SIL targets. Installing SIS equipment often happens after some factory acceptance stage. The critical part of this phase of the life cycle is to ensure that effective testing has been completed from sensor through to final element for every function. The final validation of the system can only happen at site, with all equipment connected to the process. Once an SIS is in operation, it is important that equipment is regularly inspected and maintained. Proof test procedures should have been developed for each safety function, and these will have a frequency determined by the SIL verification calculation. As demands and failures occur, these should be tracked over time in order to look for negative trends which might lead to plant or system modification. As inevitable modifications happen, these must be fully controlled under a management of change procedure. The impact of an SIS modification will likely have to revisit many of the previous lifecycle steps before work can be authorized. The final 61511 clause on SIS documentation has now been made normative. That is, it's now a shall, not a should requirement to describe the installation, have it accurate and up to date, easy to understand and fit for purpose. In addition to these requirements, all SIS documentation must show traceability back to the hazard and risk analysis phases, that is, showing a clear link from the SIF back to the hazard, other protection layers, and the risk gap the SIF is designed to fill. The list of typical safety file contents on this slide is not from the standard, but represents what most FSA leaders will be looking for when conducting an assessment.